Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. My name is Dilip Ahuja, and I'm on the faculty at NIAS. On behalf of Professor Ramamurthy, Director of NIAS, and Professor Shetter, Chairman of the Senior Associates Program at NIAS, I welcome you all to this evening's lecture being held to honor the memory of Lakshmi Nizamuddin, who was always an ardent participant in the Senior Associates Program at NIAS. In the early days of NIAS, when we did not have a lift, when the dining hall used to be upstairs, and when Mrs. Nizamuddin was confined to a wheelchair, we used to feel very bad that she was not able to participate in the dinners that invariably followed the evening's programs, such as this one. We moved the dining hall to the ground floor only for that reason. This lecture is also a part of the 9th annual NIAS DST training program on multidisciplinary perspectives on science, technology, and society. The theme for this year's program is S&T Communications. Before I introduce this evening's speaker, may I request Mr. Abdul Nizamuddin, a former Director General and Inspector General of Police, Government of Karnataka, to give us a background, give us the background about the establishment of this memorial lecture series. Mr. Nizamuddin.
Dr. Kiran Mazumdar Shah, Mr. Shah, Dr. Ramamurthy, and ladies and gentlemen. It is rather unusual for a man to introduce anything about his own spouse when her a lecture being organized in her memory. Nevertheless, I got to do that. Lakshmi, my wife, passed away 6 years ago, and she was one of those persons who was very fond of NIAS. She would never miss a single meeting of the senior associates. And as Mr. Ahuja mentioned, when the dining room was upstairs after an accident of mine, I couldn't carry her up. She would not go up. Dr. Rajaramanna hastened the construction of the dining hall on the ground floor, what we call our glass house here. On the day it was to be inaugurated, both Lakshmi and I could not attend because we had another engagement. Lakshmi was a person who was afflicted with copley age of 11, but she didn't let this handicap put her to any disadvantage in the sense she did almost everything which an ordinary person could do. It's generally been believed by my friends and others in, who know me here and know my wife, knew my wife, that I helped her a great deal. It's quite the contrary. She helped me a great deal more than I did her. She managed every affair of the household, paid the tax of the house, looked after the house upkeep, bought everything. As long as she was alive, I never saw the doorstep of any shop, even for my own needs. And she gave me plenty of time to do what I want to do, my reading, my attending various functions, etc. Never did I do anything relating to maintenance of the house. She was interested in painting, wrote poetry whenever the muse got hold of her, and started working for the handicapped at the age of 19. She worked in Madras with Mrs. Swaminathan to start with. Later on, she came to Bangalore in the 50s. She worked at the Red Cross home. In 1959, she founded the Physical Hand Association, which for which she was secretary founder. And then she collected donations by organizing a music concert by Allahar Khan, Ravi Shankar. And then she collected about 20,000 rupees, which was a big amount in 1959. After my marriage with her, she resigned from the post secretary of the association, as I was posted to Coor. The association wanted to be the vice president of the association, but she refused the offer because she said she couldn't do any work staying in Margara for the association. Subsequently, when we came to Bangalore in 1965, my being posted to Bangalore, she became the president of the National Society for Equal Opportunities for Handicap, kind of a affiliate association of the same name in Bombay, which was founded by Vijay Majhi, the famous cricketer and textile tycoon. And she organized the first sports competition, national competition for all categories of handicap, in which representatives would vary from physically handicapped, mentally retarded, leprosy cured, blind, and so on. We had about 800 delegates in the competition. Next, 2 years later, she organized the first national competition for international, for a skilled competition for handicapped person. in which handicapped persons danced, sang, and put a place also. And she organized integrated camps for both handicapped and well-bodied persons. She started a school for speech and hearing impaired children in 1980, against all advice of own friends and others who said it was impossible to start a school of that kind in Bangalore. She did it because there was only one school which catered to the needs of these speech impaired people, that was the Kotawale school. Every year she had one standard of friends until she is 10th standard. Then she organized and she was offered help by the famous conductor, Dr. Rajkumar, who performed in benefit of her organization, and she collected about 35,000 rupees, which she used to build a school in Indranagar, which is still functioning now. She was a very... The reason why I suggested Dr. Amurthy, why Dr. Kiran Bazaar must be mentioned. A few words about Dr. Kiran Mazumdar, she was formally introduced by Mr. Hoja, but I must say a few words about having known her. She is a strong, indomitable person for integrity, honesty. I have great respect, admiration for her quality of that. She started early, faced a lot of trouble. She didn't bow down to anybody who could be corrupt. She would stand her ground, hold firmly to her views and philosophy of life. And here's an example of a person who has come to one of the top leaders of the corporate world in India, caring very much for the correct means she would adopt. She did nothing wrong during her career to say that she had reached the place, top place, by adopting means were unfair, unethical. I would like you to join me in giving her a clap for integrity, honesty, all her life. And a few words about husband. Usually what happens, husbands are talked about, ladies are left, wives are left out. Here's the other way about. When Mr. Shaw and she were to be married, Dr. Kiran proposed him one, gave him a proposition. She said, "And you resign or resign when you marry, I feel that I will not resign, you resign." Mr. Shaw promptly resigned his job. And not only that, he gave all his savings to her to finance the project, and what is more, he sold a house in London for her, which is again, I think, a very noble action on the part of a husband who left his own country, settled down in Bangalore. He is now the vice chairman, and of course, Dr. Kiran is the chairman. Wise, I think I'll add the other vice, WIC, also chairman. Because I would suggest to Dr. Kiran, I know she likes to make a proposition in this public gathering, I think he should be called co-chairman. I'm speaking on behalf of husbands who should not be left out. And I recall in my 10th standard, I had a school teacher who used to tell, advise 10th standard students, were told by the teacher, never get introduced as your wife's husband. Mr. Shorten note. And another thing, that's another joke, he used to tell about ladies saying, he asked a general question to the class, which is the longest thing in the world? Somebody said river, somebody said this. No, he said, the longest thing in the world is woman's memory, he said. I apologize to all the ladies here. I'm sure Kiran will remember everything which has gone past between her and George, Mr. Shaw. I'm sorry, I'm going to call George Barasha. He's from Ireland too. Scottish. Now, Dr. Kiran is the consul for, honorary consul for Ireland. And this is, now, the subject chosen for this evening has been chosen by Dr. Kiran herself. And then if you read her bio, she has one of her courses that innovation is a must for the country. If we have no innovation, the country will be very backward. Life has to progress, it has to be dynamic. Change must occur. If you don't change for the better, you're stagnant, you decay. And I think Lakshmi also shared this trait with her. Lakshmi was very strict about integrity, very active, wouldn't stand any injustice if she came across it. I remember a case, just to mention it incidentally, of a doctor who was removed from service after an accident by the government of Karnataka. She went to minister, secretary, everything, fought for 3 months and got him reinstated. She was the first, you would be surprised to know that Bangalore was the first place in the entire country which had the handicapped people take part in the Republic Day and Independence Day parades. Both the blind and the speech hearing impaired children go, marched along with other able-bodied person on both Republic Day and Independence Day. Karnataka was again the first state to reserve jobs for the handicapped 1.5% on Lakshmi's persuasion. She also made the unusual step of, she tried very hard to bring in rules for the construction of buildings to give access. She incurred lots of opposition that even today I think we have not done that kind of thing. On this occasion, I hope somebody will think of it, the shared opposition. I'm very happy and proud to be here talking on this occasion, especially because a good friend and a long-time person known to me has been invited here as a speaker. I'm sure you will find that she has a lot to offer. She has had rich experience, difficult and easy times, most of it difficult times, but she's come through it all by sheer dint of integrity, honesty, hard work. Thank you all.
It's a privilege to introduce today's speaker, Ms. Kiran Mazumdar Shaw, who is the chairperson and managing director of Biocon Limited. She's also the chairperson of Biocon's two subsidiaries, Syngene and Clinigene. She's a highly respected person in the corporate world and has been named by Time magazine as one of the 100 most influential people in the world. Under her leadership, Biocon has grown to be the seventh largest biotech employer in the world. Ms. Shaw got her Bachelor of Science degree from Bangalore University, where she stood first in zoology honors. She did her postgraduate work from Melbourne University in Australia at the Ballarat College. She has received 6 honorary doctorates from Edinburgh, from Glasgow, from Dundee, from Roorkee, from Manipal, and her alma mater in Australia, Ballarat University. She's a recipient of several awards. I will list only a few. The Nikkei Asia Prize Award in 2009 for regional growth, the Express Pharmaceutical Leadership Summit Award, also in 2009, the WUF CLICO Initiative for Economic Development in Asia in 2007, the Economic Times Businessman of the Woman, the Business Woman of the Year Award in 2006, sorry about that, the Padma Bhushan in 2005, the Indian Chamber of Commerce Lifetime Achievement Award in 2005, the Ernst & Young Entrepreneur of the Year Award for Healthcare and Life Sciences in 2002, the Technology Pioneer Recognition by the World Economic Forum in 2000, and the Padma Shri in 1989. She's also on several prestigious committees. Again, I have only time to list a few. Since 1990, she's been a member of the Advisory Council of the Government of India Department of Biotechnology. Since 2000, she chairs the Government of Karnataka Vision Group on Biotechnology. Since 2004, she's on the Prime Minister's Council on Trade and Industry. Since 2006, she's on the Council of Management of this institute. She's a member of the governing body of the Indian Pharmacopoeia Commission. She's a founder member of the Society of the Institute for Stem Cell Biology and Regenerative Medicine. She's a member of the Board of Trade of the Ministry of Commerce and Industry. She's on the Board of Governors of IIM Bangalore. She's on the US-India CEO Forum, and most relevant to today's talk, she's a member of the Innovation Council of the Government of India. I'd like to also mention a little bit about her philanthropy. She established the Biocon Foundation in 2004 to conceptualize and implement developmental programs for the social inclusion of economically weak communities in rural and urban areas. The area of emphasis of the foundation are health, education, and environment. As Dr. Vijay Chandru mentioned in his talk this morning, in 2009, she established the Mazumdar Shaw Cancer Center for Cancer Treatment and Research in collaboration with the Narayan Hrudayalaya. It gives me great pleasure to request Dr. Mazumdar Shah to deliver the first Lakshmi Nizamuddin Memorial Lecture on India's innovation. Dr. Shah.
Thank you, Mr. Ahuja, Professor Ramamurthy, Professor Menon, my dear friend Rahim Nizamuddin, ladies and gentlemen. It is indeed a great, great pleasure and a great privilege for me to deliver this memorial lecture as a tribute to Lakshmi Nizamuddin, a woman of rare virtue and formidable stature for whom I had the deepest admiration. Lakshmi Nizamuddin, as you just heard, was a woman who was not in any way handicapped by her disability, but rather displayed courage, passion, and amazing strength to pursue agendas that were of significant socio-economic importance and transformational in their objective. She committed herself to the cause of seeking social equality for the handicapped and was, as you heard, the president of the National Society for Equal Opportunities for the Handicapped, a post that she held from 1975, and organized the first ever National Sports for the Handicapped in Bangalore the same year. I was particularly impressed by the way she directed the School for Impaired Speech and Hearing and organized talent contests for the handicapped and, as you heard, even ensured job placements for the disabled. Her unstinted support for those who were disadvantaged because of disabilities saw her fight for seat reservation at professional colleges and even their participation, as you heard, at Republic and Independence Day parades. Apart from this deep commitment to various causes, she engaged herself on various other fronts, from being a member of the Karnataka Film Censor Board to the Telephone Advisory Board, Indian Red Cross, and many other distinguished bodies. Lakshmi Nizamuddin was truly a woman of substance who drew much of her strength, even though Rahim doesn't admit it, from her husband. And Rahim Nizamuddin is someone whom I consider a very dear friend, a man of rare integrity, who I have had the privilege of knowing as a friend, and someone I have deeply admired for his sense of duty to his office and society at large. Thanks to Rahim Nizamuddin, Bangalore was the safest and most secular city in India. Lakshmi and Rahim Nizamuddin, along with their son Rahil, have epitomized the secular tenets of Indian society, particularly Bangalore, which has always been held up as an example of an open and a cosmopolitan city. And I really hope we can preserve this particular culture that we are so proud of today. You know, when I was asked to deliver this memorial lecture, it was difficult for me to choose the appropriate subject, and after much deliberation, I thought I should talk about how challenges can be converted into opportunities, just like Lakshmi did all her life, and more importantly, how such opportunities can deliver transformational change through innovative thought and action, just as Lakshmi did with her challenge of disability. As an entrepreneur, I've always been driven by the spirit of challenge. Challenge, I believe, brings opportunity, which in turn drives innovation. This, I believe, is the wheel of development and progress. India, in this country, is a land faced with endless challenges, which is what, in my opinion, makes it also the land of great opportunities. It is for us to convert these opportunities into outcomes through innovation that can turn this wheel of development and progress. So, what I have decided to talk about is India's innovation challenge for inclusive economic development. If you look at the challenges that we face today as a country, they are absolutely daunting challenges. Let's start with poverty. 80% of our population live on less than $3 a day. When it comes to healthcare, 65% of our population do not even have medical access. Sanitation is a very sad state of affairs, where only 19% of our people have access to sanitation. When it comes to education, India has a 74% literacy rate, which is well below the world average of 84%. In fact, India accounts for 35% of the world's illiterate population. And if you were to look at the statistics of literacy amongst women, it is even more abysmal, because only less than 50% of our women are literate. When you look at infrastructure, India's 3.3 million long road network, which is considered to be the third largest in the world, is not up to standards, because only 14% of this conforms to international road standards. The challenges go on. When it comes to telecommunications, we have leapfrogged, and certainly we enjoy a tele-density of 74% and the world's largest mobile phone subscriber base. But then, this means that we actually face a huge bandwidth challenge. When it comes to agriculture, 69% of our population depends on agriculture for their livelihood. But we all know that agricultural productivity is among the world's lowest. Electrification is a major challenge for our country. 400 million Indians in over 18,000 villages have no access to electricity. And nutrition is a shame for this country. 22% of our children are severely undernourished, and even worse still, India ranks 62 out of 81 countries as per the Poverty and Global Hunger Index, even below Ethiopia. To add to these challenges are those of terrorism and now corruption. But then, on the other hand, we see India as a rising, vibrant economy with the potential of being an emerging economic power. We are considered the fourth largest economy in terms of purchasing power parity, the second fastest growing economy after China, the youngest population demographics with the fastest growing incomes and aspirations. We have growing leadership in several industry sectors, like automobiles, aluminium, IT, pharmaceuticals, steel, etc. We are one of the largest milk producers in the world, again with the lowest productivity when it comes to milk productivity in terms of the cattle that we use to measure milk productivity. We have the largest mobile phone subscriber base globally, like I said, and we are emerging as a nuclear energy leader. So, as I mentioned, it is evident that unless we overcome these challenges that I posed earlier on, we cannot realize our aspirations to become a true global power. It will take enormous innovation and out-of-box thinking to convert these challenges into successful outcomes for a country as large as India. And I thought for this evening's lecture, I would just like to focus on two of these challenges, which are really monumental challenges. And these are poverty and, of course, my own penchant for healthcare. So let's start with poverty. Let's understand the magnitude of this challenge. I have touched upon some of these, and I will, at the cost of being repetitive, go through it again. As I said, 80% of our population live on less than $3 a day. 69% depend on agriculture for their livelihood. 50% of them are illiterate or poorly literate. 18,000 villages are devoid of electricity. Only 19% have access to sanitation. 65% lack access to healthcare. And 47% of children in rural India are undernourished. It seems like we are facing unimaginable hopelessness. It almost seems too dire to do anything about. It even leads people to believe that there is no point in wasting time to alleviate poverty when urban India is bounding along with rapid strides of prosperity and progress. But I believe that it is in this morass of challenges that lie enormous opportunities that will actually help us build and add to our prosperity and, more importantly, inclusive progress. The government has looked at this challenge of poverty and has found some very innovative quick fix measures. So let's start with one of these, which is the National Rural Employment Guarantee Act. This act aims to enhance the livelihood of people in rural areas by guaranteeing 100 days of wage employment in a financial year to a rural household whose members volunteer to do unskilled manual work. The government believes that this would raise a below the poverty line family's income levels from $1 a day to $3 a day, which in their view would bring it out of abject poverty. The NREGA was launched in 200 districts in 2006 in phase one. It was extended to another 130 districts between 2007 and 2008 in phase two, and covered the remaining 285 districts in phase three. This innovative scheme for inclusive development aimed at tackling rural poverty through providing a minimal guaranteed income for unskilled and farm labor that would be harnessed for rural development, especially in works related to soil and water conservation, drought and flood protection, rural road connectivity, etc., etc. 5 years later, the metrics are not that promising. Thus far, we have spent 40,000 crores, and this fiscal we have actually allocated an additional 45,000 crores. No doubt, you know, poverty has been alleviated to a certain extent, but it has actually created another problem, one of large-scale labor deficit across the farming and industrial sectors. It is well known that when people perceive such employment guarantee schemes to be dole-outs, they simply stop working. And this is what we are facing today. And we also know that there is a well-known saying that don't feed a hungry man, but teach him how to fish so that he can learn to feed himself. We need to innovate our well-intended schemes for poverty alleviation better. NREGA needs to work with sectors that are dependent on unskilled and semi-skilled labor so that such financial outlays focus more on skill development linked to income and economic sustainability. We need to have a strategy that pulls up people from the bottom of the pyramid through education and skill development. Let's start with this pyramid that I have tried to sketch. as a sustainable way of addressing the serious challenge of livelihood or the problems with livelihood that this unskilled rural people face. We need to start with basic education where computer literacy has to be a part of education to make it inclusive. I often find that today in many of our basic education and primary education programs, we do not focus on computer literacy, and this itself excludes rural children from the economic mainstreams or from even addressing opportunities in the economic milieu of our country, of our progressive part of our country. I know that we ourselves have invested in our own modest way in computer literacy, where we have actually focused first on math education and then made sure that we have actually trained rural teachers how to actually indulge in e-learning. Because it's not enough to give just computers to rural schools because they don't know how to use it to teach kids. So I think this is a very important part of basic education. And when I talk about basic education and computer literacy, I'm not just talking about teaching children, I'm talking about adult education as well. From that, you then move on to training and skill development. And it is moving up the pyramid that is very important, because you then have to focus on higher education and skill enhancement. And it is only by systematically educating and developing skills amongst our rural, illiterate people that we will be able to enable them to access the job market in a very equitable manner. So this to me is a very important aspect of innovative approaches to how we can address employment in our country. You know, if you then go to the agricultural sector, we again have to look at what hasn't worked and what we need to do to make it work. Agricultural SOPs need to move away from loan waivers and free electricity to technology upgradation and land reforms. The loan waivers adopted by the UPA 1 government has neither enabled farmers to be debt-free, nor has it addressed the more serious challenge that India faces in terms of abysmal agricultural productivity. What India's agricultural sector needs is the adoption of newer technologies and land reforms that enable economies of scale in farming. Coming from the biotech field, I certainly believe that biotechnology is one such technology that has played a very key role in India, especially in the area of BT cotton. Today, 81% of cotton grown in India is BT cotton, covering about 7.6 million hectares and has touched an annual production of 4.9 million tons, which has catapulted India into a premier cotton producer, second only to China, which also is a country that has benefited hugely from BT cotton. India used to be a net importer of cotton a few decades ago. Today, it is a large exporter of cotton, thanks to biotechnology. This particular slide actually shows that yield has increased over 30%. And in terms of return on investment to the farmer, it has been over 100% when you look at it in various dimensions. Another very important part of agricultural innovation has to be land reforms. Land reforms that enable economies of scale, that allow for efficient contract farming, that aim at increased productivity, are very urgently needed. You know, it's very heartening to see that certain states have been progressive and have taken some very, very bold steps. States like Rajasthan have announced a 30-year land leasing provision where farmers or landowners enjoy lease rentals as well as a share of the profits without losing ownership of their lands. I think today for the biggest problem we face is that farmers do not want to lose that little ownership of that very precious piece of land that they possess. And we must be sensitive to these emotional needs of people. But leasing, I think, does address this. And I think the Rajasthan government has done something very innovative. They have gone into long 30-year lease rentals with this profit-sharing kind of arrangement with the land owners and the farmers. And I think this is something that we must look at and see if we can adopt as an innovative land reforms policy. Now, with the advent of the growing retail sector, this model can lead to prosperous productivity. I personally believe these are some of the innovative ways of ensuring that we have inclusive economic development. So I would now like to turn to the next big challenge, which to me is something I'm very, very concerned about, and that is India's healthcare challenge. India's healthcare challenge begins with the urgent need to create a national healthcare system that provides quality healthcare for its billion-plus population. To this end, it is necessary to develop a comprehensive framework that incorporates an optimal balance between access and affordability. The challenge is formidable. India has an enormous disease burden across both infectious and non-communicable diseases. And with suboptimal infrastructure and meager resources to manage it, India, as we all know, is at the epicenter of diabetes, cancer, heart disease, renal and autoimmune diseases, TB, HIV, and many other infectious diseases. However, there exists a huge deficit in resources across the value chain of health delivery. We are short of 2 million hospital beds and need an additional 200,000 doctors and 1 million nurses and paramedics. We need to expand our primary, secondary, and tertiary care centers by a factor of 10. We need to treble our GDP spend on healthcare from 0.9% to 3%. If we are to actually make any sense in terms of providing basic and good quality healthcare to our people. We need to increase health insurance coverage from a mere 11% today to 100% of our population. And this can only be done through a combination of government and private sector insurance schemes. Now, although these challenges sound insurmountable, there are many silver linings around these clouds of gloom. Let's look at India's healthcare sector. The country is a world leader in generic drugs and vaccine production. And here, let me also comment that India is home to the cheapest generic drugs in the world, something which is a very powerful driver for us in the healthcare ecosystem. We have a large network of medical and nursing colleges creating human capital, but as you heard in my previous slide, not enough to cover a country the size of India. We do have a countrywide infrastructure of hospitals and clinics, but again, we need to multiply most of that by a factor of 10. A huge economic, financial and other challenges in doing this. India has the technological expertise in IT, biotechnology and telemedicine. And I think here is what we need to do to deploy all of these very innovatively and affordable in terms of affordability. We also have a fairly large insurance sector. And what is also important for me to mention here is that we have started developing very innovatively micro health insurance schemes, which I believe are very, very important for a country like India. However, when you look at all these wonderful positives that we have in the healthcare sector, we find that many of these resources have grown arbitrarily. We must integrate them through a holistic vision to ensure that healthcare is delivered to those who need it at the right time and at the right place. So, what is the opportunities and the innovative ways of dealing with this healthcare challenge? The role of the Government of India as a healthcare provider has been fraught with waste and inefficiency. Government hospitals and primary health centers have simply failed to deliver acceptable levels of healthcare, and most of these are either under or ill-equipped, poorly staffed, and financially unsustainable. For starters, I believe the government simply should not take on the role of a healthcare provider. This is better done by the private sector. In fact, the private sector accounts for more than 75% of total healthcare delivery in India. Private firms are now thought to provide about 60% of all outpatient care in India and as much as 80% of all inpatient care. And it is estimated that nearly 70% of hospital beds in the country are in the private sector. The pertinent question in private sector healthcare is one of affordability. And this can be answered if the government were to play the role of an insurance provider and ensure that the private sector provides both access and affordable healthcare to all strata of society through an effective public-private partnership model. Only 11% of the population, as I mentioned earlier, has any form of health insurance. Because so little insurance is available to the population of India, out-of-pocket payments for medical care is estimated to be approximately 95% of total health expenditures by households. Without insurance, the poor must resort to taking on debt or selling assets to meet the cost of hospital care. It is estimated that 20 million people in India fall below the poverty line every year because of indebtedness due to healthcare needs. Now, this is untenable. This cannot be allowed to happen. It is therefore imperative that more people must be brought under health insurance to alleviate poverty and address this healthcare challenge. As I mentioned earlier, one of the most innovative ways of health insurance is micro health insurance. This is an extremely affordable insurance model that can reimburse the private sector for basic patient care. Our own foundation has actually initiated a very interesting micro health insurance program called Arogya Raksha. And we are doing this in partnership with the Narayan Hrudayalaya Group and many other hospitals and secondary care clinics. And this is a very interesting model. To date, we have insured roughly 200,000 lives. And for as little as 150 rupees per person per year, we have actually delivered very good quality healthcare through a network of clinics and hospitals. And we have conducted a large number of high-end surgeries, including bypass surgeries, and many, many other kinds of surgical interventions and hospital interventions, which I think rural people have really benefited from. But this is not the job of the private sector. I believe this is the job of the government. And therefore, the government needs to embark in a very meaningful way on creating this health insurance model of micro health insurance. Many state governments have actually embarked on this model. Andhra Pradesh has initiated the Arogya Shri micro health insurance program, and Karnataka's Yashaswini has been much talked about as a very successful health insurance model, micro health insurance model for cooperatives and cooperative farmers. But I think the big challenge here is that these micro health insurance models have relied solely on government hospitals, where I think the quality of healthcare being delivered is suboptimal. And therefore, we need to see if we can innovatively create a health ecosystem where the private sector focuses on capacity expansion in terms of the infrastructure of creating clinics and hospitals, and then relying on the government as an insurer to make sure that it reimburses the costs of health delivery. Because of the size of our population and because of the fact that we have a young population, the actuaries can work for micro health insurance at a very low cost. An aging population makes it unsustainable, but I think India as a country can innovate its way in this very, very exciting and innovative insurance model. But having said that, we know from many, many other healthcare models around the world that inefficiencies, lack of transparencies, and abuse of the system can actually make healthcare very inefficient, and the delivery system can fail altogether. So we have an opportunity to create a healthcare model based on a very low-cost insurance and reimbursement system, provided we leverage technology to deliver transparency and accountability. Today, we have the makings of a strong IT backbone in this country. And we all know that today it is e-governance that can actually deal with the kinds of corruption we are talking about across all sectors. And it is IT that we need to use to make sure that we have a very efficient healthcare system. We need e-healthcare to make sure that we build high efficiencies into healthcare delivery. We need smart cards, which act as a very strong, powerful technology enabler to facilitate transparency of transactions which the government can audit through an independent watchdog. The proposed unique identification card can double up as a health card to deliver services in a very transparent manner. Moreover, if such a card were to be made into an absolute smart card, it could actually generate very useful and powerful data that could help us draw up important health indicators that in turn can enable us design both preventative and prognostic models for healthcare. This could lead to an array of enablers, starting with medical interventions, informed budgeting, and even differentiated research initiatives. This is what is possible in terms of such challenges. These are the opportunities that lie ahead of us. Leveraging technology, applying existing knowledge in a very creative and innovative way can build a very robust, unique, and novel healthcare model, which the whole world would love to then emulate. A hub and spoke approach where a tertiary care hospital provides the anchor for a number of secondary care nursing homes and primary care clinics is a tried and tested model in many parts of our country. In fact, one of the other innovative aspects of our healthcare ecosystem has to be about a PPP model where the private sector has the ability to manage our primary health centers and make them far more efficient. Only 25% of India's specialist physicians reside in semi-urban areas, and a mere 3% live in rural areas. So we know that's another big challenge, because most of our medical professionals live in urban India. And as a result, rural areas with a population approaching 700 million continue to be deprived of proper healthcare facilities. We know that telemedicine can be a powerful way to connect primary and secondary care centers with a well-equipped multi-specialty tertiary care hospital. We are going beyond that. The most exciting discussion I had in recent times was the creation of a new university for paramedical education that will create physician assistants, where such people will actually then address this huge challenge we have, where I mentioned that we have a deficit of 200,000 doctors in this country. And here we believe that physician assistants can actually expand the medical ecosystem in terms of professional skills. Physician assistants can do everything except surgeries. And I think there are some very sad realities that we have to face today in terms of maternal and infant deaths in rural areas, only because nurses or midwives are not allowed to inject patients. Today, a woman who has delivered a child who is bleeding to death dies on her way to the nearest clinic, and she could have been saved if paramedic could have been trained to give her a simple oxytocin injection. These are the realities that we have to address in a very different way. We have to expand the number of professionals in every sphere of healthcare. We have the ASHA workers who are now playing a very important role in health education. Telemedicine, as I mentioned, is a very important innovative step forward. There is already a growing movement within India to establish a health grid that connects medical institutions and practitioners throughout the country. Moreover, national networks for blood banks, transplants, and medical imagery are essential. And again, we need to take advantage of all the technology that lies before us. More recently, the use of mobile phones in healthcare education, diagnosis, and health delivery is gaining increasing acceptance in addressing the challenges posed by rural healthcare. One such program is something, again, I've been very deeply involved with. India has the highest incidence of oral cancers, and the reason is because of our tobacco chewing habits. It's very sad to see in our cancer hospitals that many of these patients, or most of these patients who come from rural areas, come with such advanced cancers that it's just too late to do anything about it. We all know that downstaging cancer, especially oral cancers, can actually make these cancers very curable. But when people come with advanced cancers, you know, the outcomes are just not possible in a positive way. So what we have done is we have actually created a mobile phone-based health education as well as a cancer mapping system, where we have trained the ASHA workers to go from house to house to collect data about tobacco consumption habits, to actually examine patients, collect data about oral lesions, take photographs of oral lesions, and transmit it back to the data site back in the hospital. Today, technology allows you to basically know where the patient is because of GPRS. And by looking at these lesions, you can actually start segmenting them into precancerous and cancerous lesions. And by catching them early, you can actually start treating these cancers early. And we are now finding that a large number of these patients in rural areas who didn't even know they had cancerous lesions are now being treated, and many, many of these patients are now cancer-free. This is how actually we need to use technology in very innovative ways. And I, for one, believe that mobile healthcare is going to be a very, very powerful, innovative way of education, awareness, as well as diagnosis and treatment. So I think these are very exciting times that we live in. So in conclusion, I would just like to end by saying that it is obvious that if India has to stride ahead, it must do so in a transformative way that includes every strata of its billion-plus population. We must develop innovative models that bring convergence between government policies and private sector investment for the greater good of the country. For in our development lies economic sustainability and prosperity for all. It is this ethos that Lakshmi Nizamuddin devoted herself to. And I would like to end by saying that it is through this tireless effort that she touched and transformed many lives. I want to end by saying, Rahim, Rahil, Soshana, Siddharth, and Sonia, thank you for giving me the privilege of paying this tribute to Lakshmi, who I truly consider a woman of substance. Thank you very much.
I heard your lecture for the first time, and I must say it is an excellent one, and it's analyzed very well. But the one thing I find missing in your innovative steps is the control over population. Now, we haven't heard anybody talking for quite many years on population. Of course, there may be various reasons people do not want to talk about it, but we can talk. What is your way? Because we are second to China in every respect, except for population. So how do you think, without any pressure, any other innovative way than what government is doing now, we can control population? And this number game itself, if you can reduce the effort required for development in poverty elevation or any other sector, will come down. Thank you.
Well, really, every one of us knows that education is going to be the answer to population control. Unless you educate people, and unless you provide people with equitable employment opportunities, I think it will be very difficult to find any other sustainable means of having smaller families. I think today we are clearly seeing that education and urbanization is leading to smaller families. And you know that dependence on agriculture is also leading to larger families, okay? And you know that, you know, if you look at countries like China and India, where we had 80% of our people's depending on agricultural livelihood just a decade ago, and if you compare it to what it is today, India still depends on 65% of its livelihood on the agricultural sector. China has reduced that to 20%. I think we have to understand that it is a combination of education, awareness, and aspiration that will actually create smaller families. Yeah, but we have to educate our people. I mean, that is a fact. I mean, unless you educate your people, you don't have a hope. You cannot do it through coercive means. You know that you cannot just have the same methodologies that you adopted decades ago, which failed. Today you have to educate people. Let people understand and figure out for themselves that one of the aspects of attaining or, you know, reaching out from their poverty status to, you know, the income generating status will have to be through smaller families. So it's education again. It's really, I believe, you have to focus a lot on educating your poor. And I think one of my slides showed it. You have to start with that basic literacy program.
Madam, I have one or two questions. One is, you said we are deficient in medical professionals, the doctors, the physicians in our country. Even if we have more physicians, how do we ensure they do not move off towards the greener pasture, towards west, or they take up educated people like doctors are getting into administrative services? Nowadays, large number of doctors get into administrative services where there is absolutely no application of the training that they have undergone. Secondly, even the private hospitals today do not deliver quality medical care. How do we ensure that these things fall in place?
Well, you know, there are no simple answers to some of the questions you've asked. But having said that, I think in terms of the professional capacity building in the medical ecosystem, it is a reality and we need to do that. There are there are various ways. I don't think there is a sort of emigration of doctors taking place from India elsewhere. There is a small percentage, but there are also a large number of doctors who are available to us in this country. There are many other innovative ways of making sure we harness this very important resource. For instance, we know that we have teaching hospitals with medical colleges with teaching hospitals associated with them. You know, you'll be very horrified to know that most of these teaching hospitals are not acting, you know, they're not really live hospitals. Very often people tell me that these hospitals are almost kind of brought to life only when there are inspections. Now, I think we need to make sure that these are resources that we have to really leverage in a big way. Most of these colleges and hospitals are in rural areas, and you should be encouraging more and more medical colleges in rural areas in India. And it is these teaching hospitals that can actually provide the medical resources that you need to even cater to the rural people in those areas. That's one of the ways of doing it. The other way is, of course, people will go to where the opportunities are. You know, you cannot handcuff a doctor and say that because you've practiced as a doctor, you cannot go to another sector. I think this is going to happen. But I, for one, believe that what we are lacking right now in the medical community is medical research. I think if you start developing a vibrant community of medical research, where clinical research takes precedence over clinical practice, okay, I think you will see a very new breed of doctors who would love to practice their profession. Today, I think you find that doctors are just, in a very clinical way, just want to practice and treat patients. There are very few doctors you find who really want to perform research, and both go hand in hand. Translational research is really something which is a huge opportunity for a country like India. And we must focus on translational research, because we know today that there are some exciting opportunities in the whole drug innovation space, in medical innovation space. You know, today, whether you talk of regenerative medicine, whether you talk of companion diagnostics, whether you talk of biomarkers, whether you talk of new treatment regimens, it's all in the hands of doctors today for them to investigate and experiment and research. That culture is missing in India. So if you were to basically transform your doctor into a researcher as well, I think you will find that this challenge that you just posed will disappear.
Thank you. Shaw, for sharing your thoughts on really how we can alleviate poverty and how we can improve healthcare systems in the country. I think that's been very good thoughts indeed. But I just thought I may also let you know, and I'm sure you're aware, that in the 12th plan, the Ministry of Information Technology has almost borrowed your thoughts, and they are planning to certainly improve the telemedicine kind of approach. I mean, they're planning to improve it. I don't know how far they'll be able to cover during the 12th five-year plan, but they do certainly have some plans in this regard. And coming to really, you know, you were mentioning generics, you know, the status of our country. Considering that so many biosimilars, you know, we are competing in the area of biosimilars, do you think that as a country we do stand a good position in the years ahead, since there are so many other countries which are also looking at drugs which are going off patent and there have been issues in this regard? And the third thing I wanted to ask you is, in respect of skill development, I think you very rightly pointed out the areas in which skill development really needs to be built up. While this would be very, I mean, when we do have a National Skill Mission Board also, which is going to look into skill development for artisans and for those who are having some basic skills. But probably there is also another issue which could be touched upon, and this is unemployment. Because there are so many who have degrees and who really haven't been able to get proper employment. So that is another aspect which, I mean, skill development, to
skill
suit
enhancement,
yes.
Really,
yeah. Or really skill deployment to suit a particular, maybe
sector.
That's an angle also that we need to think about in the country at large. Because we do have several who are very highly qualified and who really opt to take up jobs where their education levels are probably underutilized. So this was a thought I thought I should perhaps put across to you. Thank you.
Yeah, so to answer your first question, you know, the whole world is challenged with spiraling healthcare costs. And I think every, you know, healthcare system in the world has benefited greatly from generic drugs. Today, the US itself has a generic penetration of 76%. India has a, you know, generics market where 98% of our drugs really come from the generic segment. Affordability drives the penetration of generics, and every healthcare system in the world therefore depends on generics to bring down cost. Biosimilars have a similar role to play. Today, if you look at what is the highest price point of any drug, it is biologics. It is, you know, it is well known that most of these biologic therapies are upwards of $50,000 a year. And this is something which even America today finds very difficult to afford. You know that even, you know, healthcare systems in the UK and Germany and other parts of Europe today are finding it very difficult to reimburse many of the very, very expensive drugs. And there is a risk-benefit justification for them to reimburse such drugs. So, biosimilars obviously offer another big opportunity for these health systems to bring down their costs, and it is going to happen very soon. Biosimilars are already in many of the emerging markets, and they are playing a very important role. I mean, look at insulin. Today, we as a company have brought insulin to this country, and we have actually brought down the cost of insulin therapy by a quarter. You know, it used to cost four times as much about 10 years ago when there was no indigenous production of insulin. Today, those insulin prices have come down to a quarter of what they used to be. So, you know, we have driven down the prices of just insulin therapy, which for a country like India, which is at the epicenter of diabetes, where insulin therapy is an inherent integral part of diabetes therapy, it's a life-saving drug. And cancer drugs are the same, you know, this is also happening. So it's going to be inevitable. And for generic companies also, I think definitely biosimilars offer the next bolus of growth. Okay. Now, coming to the skill enhancement, suggestions that you made, yes, I think there are many, many models being developed. You know, corporates are being and industry organizations like CII and FICCI and ASSOCHAM are being asked to adopt training centers, the ITIs. They are beginning to sort of select skill deficits in specific sectors, and they are beginning to train, as you said, the educated but unskilled in that sense, to actually acquire these very specialized skills. The IT sector has been a great proponent of creating, teaching academies in their own companies to make sure that they can actually train a huge number of IT professionals to be absorbed in their workforce. Similarly, we also are doing the same through finishing schools. You know, that was one of the concepts of the vision group on biotechnology, where we felt that yes, there were a large number of biotech graduates coming out, but they were unemployable in that sense. And so we felt they needed to be trained in a particular way so that at least they can get employment and they can hit the ground running when they get into companies. So finishing schools has been a very, very interesting concept. Companies like ours are starting very similar academies like the IT sector, where it's another kind of a finishing school where we will actually take on every year maybe 100 students and train them in various needs that we have, you know. So I think there's a lot of that kind of skill enhancement and skill development that is going on. And it just has to be done at a very mega scale.
I just want to start by saying it's a great thing that people like you have really put your fingers into the health sector and public health. One comment, and I think you have come across it, is that health administration, decisions about health, whether it's the state government, central government, planning commission, district, taluk, is made by people who are neither public health experts or have the health or medical background. So unless we are able to change that, some of those suggestions that you made, which are workable, they're doable. I have worked with public health, so I can appreciate everything that you said. And we have to bring about that change. And only then we'd be able to make those decisions that make a difference to the lives for whom they were, the health systems were set up. The second comment was with regard to the life cycle approach to in health. We deal with the child, the pregnant mother. We forget the child after the basic immunization. And if the child's lucky, gets into the ICDS program, then there's nothing. Because the school health programs, they're there and they're not there. You know, I think you understand what I'm saying. And then when a woman gets pregnant and the man has to have a disease or meet with an accident to enter in a hospital. So we do not have that life cycle approach in our health planning, which also comes in the way of delivering public health. And the third is what we saw in the newspaper. They're going to raise the 1.42% to something like 4% in the next 10 years. For health in the health budget. So what you have suggested and some of the things that you've done, if we can only take it to the mega scale. And again, as a person who's dealt with health, thank you for your efforts, ma'am.
Thank you. You know, as I said, I agree with everything that you've said, but I think we have to start with building a national healthcare system. If you don't have a national healthcare system, you will never be able to do enough for delivering healthcare to all. Basically, we know that everything that happens in healthcare is fragmented, disconnected, disjointed, and you can never do things in a very efficient way. So there are bits and pieces of things happening in islands, okay, but it's not getting connected. You know that you have a Public Health Foundation of India that is really trying to look at public health in a very broad sense. You know that we have challenges in the healthcare system because it is not a centralized area. You know, it is a state-specific area. Health is today a state-specific area. So you will find certain state governments doing a lot more and others not doing anything at all. So I think unless we have a very broad national framework for healthcare delivery, it'll be very difficult to do enough to deliver on healthcare the way you're suggesting. We don't even have what is called a standard of care in this country. So if you have a national healthcare system, you can start addressing all this. You know, today we are more paranoid about doing clinical trials. Okay? And then you don't even have a proper health, ecosystem where you realize what are you doing and what, how you benefit from clinical trials. You know, I think we have to again sensitize people that, you know, clinical trials are being done in a very proper way. It is being done with a lot of regulation and ethics, but the common man feels that it is a very unethical way of developing drugs, and that has that notion has to be dispelled, because it is not so.
Good evening. My name is Dipti Rajagopalan. I'm a PhD scholar at NIAS from the School of Humanities. May I ask a personal question? Ma'am, you have been a great inspiration as a woman of willpower and strength. And my question is, what is the motivation in a woman as she finds herself in the rise of a career? And is it true that today, when a woman is on the rise of a career, she finds herself sacrificing much more than a man does?
I would like to answer that question by saying that every one of us, whether we are a man or a woman, I think we have to have a very deep sense of purpose, okay? And if you have a deep sense of purpose, it allows you to do and pursue what you want to, okay? I think anyone with a sense of purpose makes sacrifices, irrespective of whether you're a man or a woman. Women, I think, in our society, do find it very difficult. You might feel that you have to make greater sacrifices than the man. But I think we need to also build a society that is equitable in terms of both genders. And then you will not find that you have to make that many more sacrifices.
Yeah. I would like to know, do you see any role for the traditional systems of medicine in this country? Because one often hears that in China, something like 60% of the day-to-day things are taken care of by the traditional medicine, and the modern medicine comes in when you really need it. Whereas today in our country, that is probably much, much less than that. What is your view on that?
I think, you know, traditional medicine has a role to play for sure. And I think modern medicine also has its role in the medical world. It's for us to decide how we want to play those two types of medicine. I think, a traditional medicine can certainly help at a certain level of treatment. But I think modern medicine certainly has a very important role to play in advanced kind of medical conditions for sure. Well, you know, that's why I said, I think I can't sort of make comments in terms of what is right and what is wrong, but I think everything has a role to play. I mean, I myself know that, you know, sometimes when I'm not feeling well, obviously a salt water gargle helps me a lot, but then there are times where I know I have to pop an antibiotic tablet. So I think both have a very important role to play, and I think it's for us to have a standard of care, have a basic systematic approach to how we want to develop traditional medicine. I think traditional medicine can also be a treasure trove of innovation. We have not even done that properly. So I think both have a role to play. And as someone who believes in modern medicine. Obviously, I believe that modern medicine has a very important role to play. And more, the most important aspect is we should really, you know, engage in drug innovation in a big way, which is what is lacking today.
It has been a great pleasure listening to your lecture. You had mentioned about the PPP model. There was a classic case in Mumbai where the land belonged to municipal corporation and it entered into an agreement with a private party for building a super specialty hospital. You might have heard about the Seven Hills Hospital that was recently inaugurated by President Pratibha Patil. The agreement was to treat X number of patients in each of the super specialty departments that were referred from the municipal hospitals free of cost to the patients. But now that the infrastructure is ready, hospital is functional, they are refusing to treat the poor patients free of cost. So that's a total failure of the PPP model there. So what's your comment on it, and how can we ensure that such models don't fail?
See, I think the only way we can ensure that everyone is treated is to make sure that we have a reimbursement model. You know, you can only treat a certain number of free patients. After that, it becomes unviable and unsustainable. So it's not the question of X or Y. Ultimately, I'm saying if you really want it to be a sustainable model, you have to have a reimbursement model. And that's why I mentioned that the PPP model I'm talking about is where the government is the reimbursement agency or the insurance provider, okay? And the private sector is the health delivery provider, that is the healthcare provider through the hospitals or clinics or nursing homes. Today, it is you know, abundantly clear that if you tell someone to go and set up a hospital in a rural area, nobody wants to do it because they said, who's going to pay for my services? Because I will have to basically rely on poor patients, and poor patients don't have the money to pay for these services. So why should I set up a hospital in the poor regions of this country? But if the government were to say, okay, I am assuring you of reimbursement, you know, and then it becomes a very viable model. So then they don't mind treating poor patients if they get paid for those services. But then the government also has to make sure that they enter into an agreement where you get the sort of the financial agreement of how you're going to reimburse. So it has to be transparent. So when you talk, I can't comment on this particular case that you're talking about because it's anecdotal. I'm not sure whether everyone's been turned away or that they just can't, they've got too much of a demand from poor patients and they can only treat a certain number. So I'm not able to comment on what you said. But it's very difficult. I can tell you because I work very closely with Dr. Devi Shetty. If you look at the huge demand he has for discounts and free treatment, it will be impossible for him to build his hospital. Okay, if everyone wants a discount, they don't want to pay anything, you know, it's a very big challenge for us. So we need to, you know, hospitals need to be profitable so that they can expand, so that they can reinvest and expand and upgrade. Okay, so if everyone expects hospitals to be charity organizations, it becomes very difficult. So I can't comment on that particular case, but in general, I think you need to build sustainable models in healthcare. That's why I don't believe in free treatment. It has to be something where somebody pays and somebody delivers very efficient, affordable healthcare.
But in all such debates, we talk of the government role. But are we not a part of the government?
Kiran, first of all, compliments on a wonderful presentation. As usual, very, very stimulating. I have three comments to make regarding the health sector presentation. The first is that sanitation ought to form the cornerstone of any healthcare policy. And I found that that was probably not addressed as innovative, one of the innovative measures in your presentation, I'm sure is an oversight. But I do think that if you address sanitation in this country, a large percentage of our healthcare problems will settle down. The second is about medical education. Now, you mentioned that medical education in this country has produced some very good doctors. One of my concerns over the years has been that we're training doctors who cannot practice other than in an environment like a five-star place. And I think our medical education needs to reorient itself so that our graduates are able to perform whatever basic facilities are available at the rural area. That's perhaps one way of driving it. I know of kids who do not want to go to the rural areas because they say we don't have a CT scan and we don't have this and we don't have that. So if you can train your graduates, perhaps in one of the things that you mentioned about training paramedics, in some kind of a fashion. The third comment is what Professor Ramamurthy referred to, and that is the Indian systems of medicine. Now, these systems would not have survived for thousands of years if there was no good in them. But I think the gap is in the way, the paradigm in which they operate. It's totally anecdotal. I've cured cancer, I've cured this and I've cured that, but there's no proper documentation. And therefore, the two sides do not talk the same language. And I think if we can make an effort to see that we talk the same language, perhaps we can borrow from the rich wealth of material which is available in those systems.
I think, sanitation is certainly something I did touch upon in the earlier part of my presentation, and I certainly think health and sanitation do go hand in hand, that's for sure. In terms of what you talked about in terms of rural infrastructure, I for one really believe that if you want inclusive economic development, you must develop your rural centers. Why are you depriving and denying your rural healthcare centers of good modern technology? I'm sure there are, there's a lot of, ways of innovating. I know that many companies are innovating low-cost solutions, even by building low-cost CT scanners. So I think those are really what we should be doing. Not that you say that you still start dividing the country by saying poor people should only have this and rich people should have this, or urban should, can have this, but the poor should be okay, willing to put up with something else. I, for one, believe that innovation is available for any part of this country in very different ways. I mean, if you could make a nano as a car for the common man, why can't you start developing medical equipment which also can be used in other settings, And I think it is happening. I, for one, have worked very closely with various people who are innovating based on this drive of affordability. GE themselves have come up with very low-cost models for various types of medical equipment. A friend of mine has come up with a very low-cost but very high-end diagnostic equipment which can operate in a very rural setting and actually does much more than your very large, expensive diagnostic equipment. So I think this is what will drive new types of innovation. I don't think we should be boxed into thinking that only certain things work. In fact, that poverty and that affordability should drive a very new type of innovation. Many people talk about it as innovation. But these are the kind of opportunities that lie before us, and we should do that. And in terms of traditional medicine, I for one, yes, I do believe that it offers you a very rich sort of substrate for research, and I think you have to do it in a very scientific way. You have to do it systematically. You have to do clinical trials that will show you that this particular herb or Ayurvedic drug actually works very well. And I think if you do it systematically and do it in a scientific way, you can create very, very convincing data, and it can become a very integral part of our medical practice.
For you, my intervention, and Dr. Kiran mentioned the fact that government should start reimbursing the treatment of poor people in private hospital. Government has taken a step in the direction in regard to central government servants. And as central government scheme, those of such as the patients who are working in the central government, also in All India Service, like ISIPS, Indian Forest Service, if they feel the need to be treated in private hospital, they can go there after recommended by a private hospital. There's a kind of beginning in the sense the private hospital reimburses the treatment of people who work in governments.
You spoke about the lack of a proper legal protocol for clinical trials.
So is there any possibility of the government bringing in some legal protocols for clinical trials wherein more people who cannot afford the treatment can be brought under the trials?
No, there is no such thing as there is an adequate legal framework for clinical trials. I think everything is there. You know, patient enrollment takes place on certain selection criteria. So when you enroll for a clinical trial, but the awareness has to go with people. See, a lot of people don't even know that there are things called clinical trials. So I think the awareness of enrolling for clinical trials needs to be made much more widely known.
Kiran, thank you very much for talking about how a sense of purpose, spirit, and compassion for others makes great things happen, both in your life and in my mother's life. My question to you is around patient as partner. One of the realized risks in the West has been super specialization and the complete loss of the GP. And rather than bemoan the loss of the GP, I think, and the question to you is this, as you spoke about educating people about oral cancer through the ASHA network and mobile phones, can we talk about educating the patient about how they can take care of themselves and through the various delivery systems that you speak about? I'd love to hear some of your thoughts about that.
I think that's absolutely a very important part of, you know, the whole healthcare challenge that we have. Health education, health awareness is becoming extremely important. And you'll be very happy to know that there are endless numbers of health education camps on whether it is diabetes, whether it is nutrition, whether it is just simple initiatives of washing your hands and sanitation like Guru just talked about. There are enormous amounts of education camps. What is very interesting is that whenever these camps are held, because you know a large number of pharmaceutical companies are holding these camps in villages, because suddenly now the rural patients are becoming quite an important target for many, many companies. And I think they are holding a lot of health education programs, awareness programs and things like that. And what is interesting is most of these programs actually are being attended largely by women, because they are the ones who can attend these camps, whereas the men work and they don't really sort of find time to attend these camps. So there's a huge revolution happening there, because it's women who are going to transform our societies. I really believe that. I think it is educating the woman to understand what health and sanitation is about. Actually, even the health insurance program, we've realized, is better delivered through women than through men. Because I often find men saying, "Arey, why should we pay so much? If I don't fall ill, can I get back my insurance?" And in fact, you see a lot of these ads in TVs where that fellow is trying to hurt himself because he has not claimed his health insurance on the last day. So these are little challenges we have about the concept of health insurance. Women seem to get it. You know, the women immediately understand what is this insurance they're talking about. So a lot of people want to kind of dodge the insurance by saying, okay, when I don't want to take insurance, but when I fall ill, I want free treatment. You know, so you have to get over that kind of mental block. So I think we have challenges, you know, and I think we need to make sure that the government plays its role, the private sector plays its role, and we must build a viable, sustainable model. I think that's what the challenge is. And there are a lot of innovative ways of doing it. I think you have to use, technology to deliver transparency and drive down transactional costs and collect the right kind of data that allows you to plan for your healthcare, you know, resources.
This is the mobile healthcare and the oral cancer that you really brought out, and I think that's really a good model, where you know, this mobile thing is there and one can take the photographs and get the treatment. The mobile as it is has also become very affordable and is there with many of the many people all around the country. Diabetes, as you have also mentioned in quite a bit of your presentation, is at another disease which many people are suffering with, and this mobile technology and also the management will be much more useful to the society at large.
Yeah, it's being used in a very effective way. You know, compliance is another big issue that we are facing in the country, and using the mobile phone to drive compliance is another big area. Wellness management is becoming a big, approach in terms of healthcare. And, for instance, Rahil, you mentioned about the GP. And I think what I absolutely agree with you, our over-dependence on specialists limits us. So what we are saying is we are actually, and today in India, even though we are at the heart of diabetes, we have 40 million diabetics in India, and yet we have very few diabetologists, if you really look at how diabetes is managed. So what a lot of companies are doing, including ours, is a diabetes education with the GP level, at the GP level, so that the GP can actually treat and manage diabetes better. Today you will be very surprised, most GPs are very scared to go beyond metformin. So they, once they have to go beyond metformin, they immediately refer those patients to diabetologists. Whereas the GP should be able to actually go all the way to insulin. So this is some of the things that are being done. Maybe I can only take one more question.
Thank you, madam. Your talk was very, very inspiring. I'm very happy that in the public health history of India, for the first time we have launched the lymphatic filariasis elimination program. Hope you will be aware that there is a master administration is given annually, single dose of two drugs. One is albendazole, another one is DEC. Albendazole, each tablet costs 12 rupees. That we are getting as a donation from multinational company, plus Smith Clinic. Whereas the DEC is one of the cheapest drug, but many a times we are running this program since 2000. But the LF elimination day is postponed just because of the not getting on time, or adequate supply is not there, or sometimes the quality is bad. I want to hear from you whether the private sector can rise to this occasion to ensure adequate supply of DEC and also ensure the quality drug, if not possible, free of cost.
Well, basically I would answer your question by saying it's a question of proper supply chain management. You just have to be able to identify who are your partners in this program and ensure that they deliver on time of the right quality. I don't think it's for private sector in general to kind of rise to the occasion, because I think private sector has risen to the occasion. I think, we are, as I mentioned, world leaders in the production of generic drugs, and I think we are producing the lowest cost drugs, and I don't think private sector or anybody should be allowed to just expect them to keep donating things free of cost. I mean, would you go to your doctors and say, please give your service free of cost? I think everything falls on drug companies. I think you must understand that drugs actually account for less than 15% of the total healthcare cost. You are not going to go to a hospital. I mean, yes, you can go to a hospital and say, please give me free hospitalization. You can go to your doctor and say, please give me free, treatment, and don't charge for your services. But that's endless. That is not going to solve our problems. We have to have a reimbursement model that is sensible, and where we must focus on building an affordable healthcare model based on all the strengths we have. And that's the way forward.
May I now request Dr. Sulochana to propose a vote of thanks.
You have answered so many questions, but my only comment is that for all this, also you have to find an innovative method of execution. That is actually very important.
You're absolutely right. We always suffer because we have great ideas, but we never implement them.
That's what I wanted to say.
Yes, absolutely.
Respected dignitaries on and off the dais, respected Chair, and respected Dr. Kiran Mazumdar. It is my great pleasure and privilege to extend a vote of thanks. I express our sincere thanks to the Chair and Dr. Kiran Mazumdar. And also the Nizamuddin and family and the dignitaries on behalf of NIAS and my own behalf. I also extend sincere thanks to my friends and other staff. Thank you.